behalf of Bond, the BGLTSA, Q, the Journal of Sexual Orientation and Public Policy, and the Kennedy School GLBT Caucus, and the Institute of Politics, welcome to redo marriage rights in the state of Massachusetts. It is my pleasure to present to you our moderator, Timothy E. Cook. He is the adjunct professor, is a Furlied Dickinson Jr. Professor of Political Science at Williams College, where he has taught since 1981. Cook was the first occupant of the Lawrence Lombard Chair as visiting associate professor in 1989-1990, and has been affiliated with the Shorenstein Center on the Press, Politics, and Public Policy since that time. In 1995, he was visiting professor of political science at Yale. His books include Making Laws and Making News, Media Strategies in the U.S. House of Representatives,
lots of other things.
Lots of other
things. I'm only
moderate. This is what I'm supposed to do. He has also published widely on political communication in the United States, political socialization, and representation in Congress. Cook received his BA in 1976 from Pomona College and his PhD in political science from the University of Wisconsin in 1982. This year.
Great.
Yes. Don't tell us. This year, Professor Cook teaches two courses at the Kennedy School. One is called Media Strategies and Governance, and the other is the Politics of Sexual Diversity. It's all yours.
Great, thank you. Thank you for coming out tonight, especially in the fact that there's all sorts of other politics and all sorts of other things going on at Harvard. It's a privilege to be here and to have this distinguished panel. As Cliff has indicated, he is one of the stalwart people in first ever Kennedy School class on lesbian and gay politics, which is called The Politics of Sexual Diversity, Lesbian and Gay Politics in the United States and Beyond. And the and beyond is to refer both and beyond lesbian and gay, as well as and beyond the United States. We've looked at a great deal of literature. I mean, one of the great things about teaching in this area, I did a review essay a couple years ago for the American Political Science Review. I was commissioned to do this on recent empirical work on lesbian and gay politics, and I was very heartened to find that there actually is a lot of very strong empirical work being done out there. 5 years or so ago, I could not have done this kind of class, but we've had, a terrific experience in the classroom. One of the things that we've ended up studying in this has been the question of public policies. We spend most of the first half of the semester talking about definitions and questions of the politics of sexual identity, questions of public opinion, questions of the status of the law. But that one of the things that we then tried to wrap this all together with were different kinds of public policies. And my logic was that there were sort of three different kinds of public policies that affected lesbians and gay men in particular, but it also addressed the politics of sexual diversity. One is the question of what we might think of as civil liberties, namely the question of non-discrimination laws in particular, and the question of where they have been passed, what effect they've had, and so forth. Another has been where there are issues and concerns that disproportionately have impacted, or affected, I guess, I don't like impact as a verb, but affected lesbians and gay men as a community. And where, as opposed to the 1970s, where you could just say libertarianism was sort of the call of the day, especially among gay men, in other words, you know, just leave us alone and everything will be fine, the rise of AIDS and the epidemic actually made it necessary to go and pursue resources from the state in a new way. And then there's this third category, which I would take to be lesbians and gay men trying to have access to resources that just about everybody else has, and that for some reason are foreclosed to them. And the example we looked at was actually what came to be known rather cumbersomely as gays in the military, or also lifting the ban on lesbians and gay men in the military. But a very close cousin to that in some ways, although on the surface it wouldn't look like it's a close cousin, is the question of marriage. Because in many ways, what was striking about looking at both the military issue and the marriage issue, is that this is something that would not involve a large expenditure of money. In fact, in the case of the military, it would probably save money to let lesbians and gay men openly serve rather than spend millions of dollars getting them out of the military. In the case of marriage, what has been most striking is that actually the more controversial measure members have been establishing a domestic partnership registry rather than, say, cities providing domestic partner benefits. Providing domestic partner benefits, such as health benefits and so forth, actually costs money. A domestic partnership registry, if any of you have had the sort of anticlimactic experience of registering as a domestic partner in the city of Cambridge, you know that it doesn't cost anything because it's basically simply the same marriage registry as they had before. Nonetheless, that is the more controversial and the less frequently enacted of those measures. And so in many ways, there is this curious kind of politics around this that has very little to do with resources and a great deal to do with symbolism. And a great deal to do with the question, here are two institutions of the United States, conservative institutions of the United States, and you would think that many people would be delighted to say, let us apply these to lesbians and gay men and incorporate them into these two conservative institutions. But as we know, the politics of all of this has gone in rather different ways. What we're going to be discussing tonight is the current politics in Massachusetts and the current politics around this very big issue nationwide. And we have a distinguished panel, and I won't give you anywhere near the kind of buildup for them that Cliff gave to me, I apologize, because they insisted that we should get kind of down to business. But going from this direction to that direction, we start with Mary Bonato, who is an attorney at the Gay and Lesbian Defenders of Boston, known as GLAD. GLAD has been key in many of the litigations in New England regarding rights for lesbians, gay, bisexual, transgender, etc. people. And in particular, GLAD was very involved in the litigation that resulted in the victorious lawsuit that then basically forced the Vermont legislature and the Vermont governor to put together an equivalent of marriage in the form of civil unions. On Mary Bonato's left is State Representative Alice Wolfe, who is from Cambridge, Democrat from Cambridge, has been in the State House for three terms? Is that
my third term?
Third term, okay. And prior to that had been mayor of Cambridge. And so we have just talked, and it was my recollection that when Ms. Wolfe was mayor of Cambridge, that the discussion about domestic partnership began in the city of Cambridge. Cambridge now has a domestic partnership registry, but that there is this controversy that many of you are aware of that's going on, which is that there has been a successful lawsuit filed that basically says that, in this complicated Massachusetts way, that the state legislature has to give the permission to the city of Cambridge to have domestic partnership, and so that consequently this has now moved to the state level, in addition to a variety of other legislation that's going on. So that we're operating in many ways on two fronts, because Mary Bonato's group has currently brought a suit, I think it was 2 weeks ago, is that right? Somewhere in that vicinity, on behalf of a variety of same-sex couples, very similar to the Vermont litigation in many ways, to try and have the right to marriage. And then there is also the question of a variety of defensive marriage acts and so forth, as well as the controversy over Cambridge's and other domestic partnership laws that's going on in the State House. Then to Alice Wolfe's left is Janet Halley, who has recently landed on these shores from Berkeley and is now professor of law at Harvard. She's the author of a splendid book called Don't. Neither she nor I could remember the subtitle, but let me just tell you it's So I meant to bring it tonight to say it's a great book, but it is about the, yes. That's okay. So it's published by Duke University Press, however, and it's a splendid book on the politics and the law around the ban on military on lesbians and gay men. And so she will be speaking. And then way down there is Evan Wolfson, who is currently the director of the Freedom to Marry Project based in New York City. And many of you may be familiar with Mr. Wolfson for at least two important cases, one of which was the case that in some ways started all of this, which was the litigation in Hawaii. That looked like it was going to be the first opportunity for there to be marriage among members of the same sex. But also Mr. Wilson went all the way to the Supreme Court with the Dale case, which was the case brought against the Boy Scouts of America. And another important case, albeit one that was lost by, as is often the case in the Supreme Court these days, by one vote. we didn't quite draw straws, but we kept on reshuffling the order. And the final order that we ended up with was that we will go, start with Mary Bonato, who will give some of the kind of the background to what's going on now. And then we'll turn to Alice Wolfe, who will talk about the legislative politics of what's going on there. Then turn to Evan Wolfson for some thoughts, and then Janet Halley will wrap it all up. So, Mary, it's all yours.
Thanks. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I want to cover a little bit of ground. I want to talk a little bit about the mass case that we filed on April 11th. But before I do, I just want to set out a little bit how we at GLAAD think about this as attorneys, this whole marriage issue. And as attorneys, you can't help but notice that marriage is a gateway to hundreds of rights and protections and responsibilities at the state level, and over 1,000 at the federal level, and all but a handful of these protections and obligations are off limits entirely, absent marriage. So in other words, there's this huge framework, the safety net of laws to apply to families at times of hardship, all kinds of protections, and they are off limits. We're not talking about just one issue. We are talking about hundreds and hundreds of issues here. Very often in, you know, at GLAAD and Evan would do this at Lambda Legal Defense, we would bring a case, we litigate for 6 years, 7 years, trying to get access to one protection for one person trying to open a door. So with marriage, we are really talking about that magnified well over 100 times. So we see marriage as, in part, a gateway to these hundreds of benefits. Let me give you a couple of examples that have arisen at GLAAD in the not-so-distant past at all, but just to give you a couple of illustrations of this. We talked to a man, in fact, my colleague Jennifer Levi, saw her in the audience. She spoke with this man also, who has been partnered with a fire chief for 45 years, firefighter, later became a fire chief, for 45 years. Well, after 45 years of service, you might imagine that this gentleman was entitled to a pension, received a pension, retired. Guess what? The pension died with the firefighter. What's the purpose of a pension? The purpose of a pension is to protect the worker and his or her family so that after the worker has died, there's usually a joint survivor annuitant option. You can provide protection for your family after you're gone. Not so if you don't fit into this marriage category for the most part. So this guy's pension died with him, and it plunged his survivor into economic chaos that would not have occurred had this gentleman been married. Second issue, talked to a lawyer from Western Mass recently. Talking to me about a situation she was facing, representing a woman who had been with her partner for 39 years. After 39 years, these two women had accumulated $80,000 in a house that they jointly owned. Well, one of the women needed nursing home care, had to be placed in a nursing home. Well, very few people can afford nursing home care. Usually that means the state, the federal government, had to come in through Medicaid. If you're married, the house that you jointly own is off limits in terms of Medicaid trying to grab it to pay for the cost of care if you're married. In other words, the spouse who remains in the community can continue to live in the house, not have to worry about being thrust onto the street. Not so if you are a lesbian couple and you are not married. Not only were there $80,000 available as assets to pay for Medicaid, but so was the house. The best that this lawyer could do was try to make an argument that she should be able to retain for her client some fraction of that money that they had accumulated over all of their years together and not be put out of the house too soon. That's because of marriage laws. Sorry, I shouldn't point to that. Third issue, which I just talked to an attorney about 2 days ago, involves a lesbian couple who've been together 15 years. And again, you know, the kinds of protections that come with marriage, you usually don't think about until you need them. And this is a perfect example of that principle with this couple. So after 15 years, one of the women in this couple, it needs to bring a malpractice action for some faulty medical care she received. And the response of the other side has been to try to get, subpoena the diaries of the other partner, and to try to get the other partner to testify about all of the conversations that the two have had, to try to fish something out that would somehow cast some damage or some aspersion on the partner who is suing. If they were married, those conversations would be entirely off limits and protected by spousal privilege. Now, those are just three examples of many that I could give. So first, as lawyers, we cannot help but see marriage as a gateway to hundreds of protections, and that those protections can be very, very important when you need them. And they follow you, I can't say quite cradle to grave, but certainly the protections for people as they age are very, very profound. plugs into a common vocabulary of love and commitment and family that we understand everywhere. If you go into an emergency room and you say, this is my spouse, you're trying to sign somebody up for benefits at work in the human resources department and say, this is my spouse, or you get a call from the IRS and they want to only talk to, you know, the family unit, and you say, well, that's my spouse. Everybody knows what that means. People don't sing songs about domestic partnership. They don't sing songs about civil union. Everybody knows what a marriage is, and that's actually one of the benefits of marriage. And beyond that, beyond knowing what it means, there's, because marriage plugs into this vocabulary of love and commitment, I really do think that there are ways in which same-sex couples and families are harmed by not having access to that vocabulary, and it makes our relationships permanently better and definitely inferior. The third thing I want to say, and this is something that I really came to appreciate through some of the testimony in Vermont, and particularly the testimony of an historian from Yale named Nancy Cott, who's written a book on marriage, by the way, called Public Vows, and I don't remember the subtitle of that one either. Something about marriage as a political institution in the United States. Anyway, she talked about how historically marriage has been a badge of citizenship and gave the example, not that it's 100% parallel because it's not, but gave the example of how slaves were not permitted to marry because slaves were not free. Now, obviously, gay people are not in the position of slaves, but at the same time, it certainly speaks volumes about the level of citizenship and freedom that gay people enjoy, that this basic civil right is not available because you happen to have fallen in love with someone of the same sex. So that's how, at least to sort of frame up some of the key issues, that's how we see the marriage issue. And I think to tell you a little bit about the case, following the court victory in Baker versus Vermont in 1999 and the enactment of the civil union legislation just over a year ago in Vermont, you know, certainly people have been coming to us for a very, very long time seeking marriage, seeking the simple, equal solution of marriage, seeking access to the same thing that everyone else has. And we finally decided that this was the right time to do it, and it was the right place to do it. Massachusetts, I don't know if some of you are from Massachusetts, but Massachusetts certainly has some very, very proud traditions and some very proud histories in terms of its both legislation and court rulings in the equality area. This is a state, for example, was the second state in the country to approve of a lesbian and gay civil rights law back in 1989. You know, the first state to actually amend its student non-discrimination law to include sexual orientation, you know, include sexual orientation in its hate crimes laws. And in the courts, we were the second state, 3 months behind Vermont, to approve second parent adoption at the appellate level. And in 1999, won a very important case. With respect to establishing the doctrine of de facto parenthood. So the people who are not necessarily married to their partners or have adopted these children can nonetheless be considered de facto parents based on the relationship the person has developed with the child. So there are certainly some very, very positive things to point to here. And the Mass Constitution, which dates back actually to 1780 and has been amended relatively little since that time because it was intended to endure for generations, as well as, says things like, all persons are born free and equal and have certain natural, essential, and unalienable rights, among which may be reckoned the right of enjoying and defending their lives and liberties, that of acquiring, possessing, and protecting property, and fine, that of seeking and obtaining their safety and happiness. What does that have to do with marriage? We think a whole lot. We think this is a basic issue about being free and equal and having the right to happiness, and certainly have found plenty of good material to work with as the courts have decided these things over. But I can't, and just before I end, I know my time is probably very short, so I don't think I'm going to say. The real heart and soul of this issue is always the people who are involved. And in the Massachusetts case, we represent seven couples who come from one end of the state to the other, really from all walks of life. If you go to our website, which is www.gladgld.org, you will see, for example, these sweet little pictures of the clients. You know, the named clients are Goodrich Hill. Five-year-old daughter Annie. I don't know if you can see this. She's there with her teeth out. And anyway, I really commend you to take a look at some of this. If you go to the website, the complaint is also there. And what you will see is that these are all people. They've been together anywhere from 5 to 30 years. They've all made a commitment. They all have the aspiration to be with each other for life. And they are simply asking their government to treat them equally. that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Alice, except to say I'm going to reserve 30 seconds after Alice is done to just talk a little bit about, to follow up on something that I know she's going to talk about.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm very pleased to be here with you today. And I would like to kind of provide, I'm going to talk mostly not about law so much as about politics and about how we got here. And I'd really like to, first of all, I want to recognize the enormous, wonderful work of Mary Bonato, with whom I have worked actually for a number of years. She's also a constituent of mine. And we have worked together on the local partners ordinance, and we're working together now at the State House on a number of pieces of legislation. And it is wonderful to know that Mary can be found on the other end of the cell phone line or telephone line. She's just a wonderful person, as well as a very competent and knowledgeable person. I want to talk a little bit about how I came to this. You have heard that I was elected official in Cambridge. I am now a state representative. Are sitting in my district, for those of you who don't know that. Like other representatives, I represent about 40,000 people, just over 40,000 people in the city of Cambridge. I want to kind of bring you here a little bit with a little history, because particularly as there are a number of students here, and I was reminded when I was out talking on a different subject, that many of you have not lived through some of the prior battles. You read them in the history book, but they're not part of your consciousness. So I'd like to just tell you a little bit about where I came from in working on the issues around the gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender community. The first term that I was elected to the city council, which is now close to 2 decades ago, I worked with many of my constituents in being elected, and one of the things that I committed to and said that I would work on when I became a city councilor was a human rights ordinance, a civil rights ordinance that would include sexual orientation in it. And lo and behold, I was elected in 1983 to city council and served. In the first 6 months of the first term, working with one of my colleagues under circumstances which, if I had a little more time, I'd be a great war story. But I worked with one of my colleagues to put together a very comprehensive human rights ordinance for the city of Cambridge. Harvard Law student who helped me to draft that. That was adopted by the Cambridge City Council in 1984, and it was the first civil rights law on the basis of sexual orientation in the Commonwealth, perhaps in all of New England at the time. It preceded the state law, which came, as Mary has mentioned, in 1989. Subsequently, and so we kind of had to start. Now, that ordinance got a 5-4 vote of the Cambridge City Council. When I became mayor in 1990, I think since the time of 1984, when I became mayor in 1990, on the day of the Gay Pride Parade, I, along with some Cambridge residents, opened up City Hall for a brunch to the gay and lesbian community. And it was one of the most moving experiences that I have had in my political life, because hundreds of people came to come to City Hall, which for the first time was opened up to the community, and people wept in the halls of City Hall. And it was an amazing experience, and then we all marched over the Longfellow Bridge to the Gay Pride Parade and marched as a community. Subsequently, as you have heard, I had a task force during the time that I was mayor. Mary was a member of that task force. We put together the domestic partners legislation, which included the domestic partners registry, the ability for domestic partners to be considered family in hospital visits, and also to have access to their partners' children's as well as to have domestic partners, about health insurance benefits for domestic partners who work for the city of Cambridge. Now, I think it's long enough ago that I can admit here that we were aware of the fact that this ordinance stood on shaky legal ground. But we fought for it, and I said to Mary, Mary, what is the probability that this ordinance is legal for the city to adopt without a humble petition? You're not responsible. You gave the correct political answer. And you told me, it's probably 35-40% that it is. And that I would have preferred over 50. But I knew that there was no way that any home rule petition, which we'll get into talking about in a minute, would pass the state legislature at that time. Remember, I've already told you about 5-4 votes in the Cambridge City Council, and Cambridge at least has the reputation, not always totally correct, of being a very progressive liberal community. I made the decision, Mary did not make the decision, I made the decision that we would go ahead with the ordinance anyway, that your 40% is not zero, to pass the ordinance, because I knew there would be no way for many years, and I was totally right, getting any such ordinance passed through the state legislature. And we did pass it. And in fact, for 10 years, nobody challenged it. No citizen, nobody came along to challenge it. It was only when a political group decided, based on some other actions, to challenge it really recently, what, about a year, year and a half ago, did this become an issue. So employees of the city of Cambridge did have domestic partners benefits over those years. By the way, the court did not declare illegal the registry or the other benefits. So even at that, some benefits exist. Now again, the domestic partners ordinance, which did pass the city council in 1992, was also adopted on a 5-4 vote. And I'm kind of telling you this history because now those issues in the city of Cambridge have unanimous support of the city council. In fact, the city council has just again adopted a home rule petition to bring to the state legislature on a 9-0 vote. And the climate in Cambridge in that respect has changed. And I believe, and I'm taking this long route to tell you this, I do believe that the climate all over the country has changed quite dramatically over those 20 years in terms of like the word acceptance, but of recognizing the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender community as part of our citizenry, and of being and really trying to protect a certain number of rights for all people. So that brings us kind of to today. Now, having said that, there is still an enormous amount of opposition. Even in our state legislature, again, we talk about Massachusetts, great progressive Massachusetts, the only state to vote for this one or that one. In fact, in our legislature, there is still a lot of resistance to not only the idea of marriage for the GLBT community, but also even for the idea of what seems to me like a no-brainer for domestic partners. And I am the chief sponsor, I was last term and I am this term, of the domestic partners legislation in the legislature. We have 40 co-sponsors of it. There are 160 members of the House and 40 members of the Senate. That's a pretty good number of co-sponsors. But we have, even on that basis, a very hard road ahead in terms of the domestic partners legislation. And now we have the converse, which is a Defense of Marriage Act, which is coming up very soon, which was filed by one of the now chairman of Ways and Means, that's a very powerful position, and not only was filed by him, but also was simple, fairly simple bill, and this now goes further, and basically we believe, or we have been advised by our attorneys, that we believe that the other language would in fact bar us from passing domestic partners legislation as well as civil unions and marriage. I mean, not, would not recognize any of those, any such legislation. So we're in a very tough fight. There is tomorrow, in fact. Oh, I do have to tell you this. I have 1 minute left, so this, but I do have to tell you this. As a result of the work that I've been doing and the fact that I filed the domestic partners legislation, I have now been targeted by one of the far right groups for fundraising. And I am the radical feminist who is pushing this agenda. And it took them a long time to find out, I guess. Along with Diane Wilkerson, who is another sponsor of a bill in the Senate. Next, the DOMA bill, so that you know, will be coming up on May 17th at 1 p.m. in the Judiciary Committee. Anyone who would like to come and testify or would like to send testimony to testify is invited. And there's going to be a press conference that morning at 10:30 at Nurses Hall at the State House to protest against that legislation. I'd just like to make one last point, if I may. I've mentioned that I am the chief sponsor of domestic partners legislation, and I have numbers of co-sponsors, there's a group of us who have been working together really on this for quite some time. You might ask whether or not we have filed any legislation relating to marriage or to civil unions, and the answer to that is no. And I would say, I think I can get Mary to corroborate this for me. I was in a political meeting that took place before we filed legislation. I was the last one standing who wished to file such legislation, and all of many people who are well known, we won't go into who, did not want to do that. They felt it was too much of a political liability at this time, particularly with the lawsuit coming up. So that part is still a work for the future. We hope maybe the lawsuit will be successful and we won't have to do that. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks to Representative Wolf, and now Mary Donato gets her 30 seconds.
Or even less. For any of you who are interested in knowing more about this issue, I brought materials from the Freedom to Marry Coalition of Massachusetts. Please feel free to take them. They've also made it incredibly easy for you to send in testimony by email. They have a system that sorts out where you live and who your rep is and who your senator is. And that website is www.equalmarriage.org. But anyway, I'll leave the materials here if anyone is interested to find out more about what they're doing and how you can get involved in the grassroots effort.
Okay, Evan Olson, please.
Thank you. First of all, I really want to thank Representative Wolf for the reminder that the words 5-4 don't always have to be bad. and also for the very important reminder that these civil rights struggles take a long time, and it's easy to be the ones who come in at the end when the country has plunged forward and there's the critical mass and everybody is saying yes, yes, and pretending that they don't even remember what the fuss was about, as we often hear mouth today, around the civil rights struggles of race, for example, where we all know that work must continue. We all know what the battles for decades and decades over centuries were like. And today, to hear from some of these groups on the surface, it's as if that never happened. Everybody was always in agreement. It's just gay is something different. So it's great to have a reminder that what counts is where we stand, where we get involved when we're pushing it forward, not when we're just acquiescing in the work that other people have done or the faint social consensus that ultimately comes. And I also really want to thank Mary for her reminder that what this is really about at its core is real people who want to live their lives, share their lives, design design their life plan, pursue happiness, and have everything that they're entitled to have as people, but are being denied still in our country. I could echo that for the remainder of my time, because Mary is quite correct to put that front and center. This is about real people's lives. It's about the opportunities they have, the protections they need, the justice they don't have at times of crisis. But rather than echo what Mary said, I'd like to use my time to make an additional point. And that takes off from what Professor Cook said. Professor Cook talked about the struggles over partnership recognition and registry, and made the point that it seems to be that many people in this country, or I should say many groups in the opposition in this country, have a problem with what is actually symbolism. And I actually have to beg to differ with that, because I don't really think this is about symbolism at all. This is about a real struggle that is going on in our country today, just as it has gone on in our country every generation. And that struggle is between those who believe, as I think most of us in this room do, that everyone in this country has the right to be both different and equal, and that no one should have to give up her or his difference in order to be treated equally. It's a clash between people who hold that view and other people who have a very different agenda, an agenda of imposing their particular parochial views, of imposing their particular judgments as to how people should live, their particular, in some cases, prejudices, and who are not afraid to try to use government as a weapon to force other people to live their lives according to how they think those people should live. This is not just symbolism. This is a very real struggle. It is a struggle that every generation is called upon to wrestle. Lesbians and gay men are not the first people to be denied equality under law. We are not even the first people to be denied justice and the opportunity to take on the commitment of marriage. As was mentioned earlier, marriage has long been a battleground in the generational, cyclical struggle over equality. There was a time in our country when African Americans were not allowed to marry at all, as Mary mentioned. And that was done as part of an edifice and as a mechanism of dehumanization. It was a way of saying that those people were not truly equal, were far from equal, were not citizens, were far from citizens, and in fact, were not even human. They were slaves. The denial of marriage and the recognition of even their relationships amongst themselves was part of that mechanism. And that was wrong, and we changed it. And then in our country, we put in place an edifice of laws that said, all right, we're going to allow those people, quote unquote, to marry, but only if they marry, quote unquote, the right person. We're not going to allow people to marry somebody of, quote unquote, the wrong race. And we had a whole regime that lasted not just from the Civil War, say, to the turn of the last century. This lasted into the lifetimes of many of the people, I think actually all the people sitting on this side of the table. It was only in 1967 that the Supreme Court finally struck down this regime of saying that people could not marry, quote unquote, the wrong kind of person. And by the way, that was, of course, the best named case ever, Loving versus Virginia. Well, that restriction on who could marry, which the court noted was part of the mechanism of white superiority. That regime was wrong, and we changed it. And there was a time in our country when women who married actually lost legal ground. They went from being people to being chattel, to being the property of their husbands. Women lost legal rights when they got married. And that was wrong, and we changed it. But when we changed it, there was a hue and cry that the world would come to an end. The very same kinds of opposition that we see today against gay people seeking the commitment of marriage came out and said, if we allow women to have this stature of equality, within 25 years, one quote went, the state of Connecticut will be a smoldering mass of ruins. Well, we're in Massachusetts, but I think we're okay in Connecticut as well. It was wrong, and we changed it. And there was a time in our country when people were told that no matter how failed or abusive their marriage was, they had to remain locked in it. They could not leave. That was wrong, and we changed it. These were major changes in their time. These were important changes, and they were right changes. And the same kind of opposition that we hear today to gay people's equality is the opposition we heard at every step in the way as different Americans, different human beings, sought the ability to participate equally and to have the choices, the full range of choices that ought to be granted to everyone and not have them denied simply because they were making different choices. This is not only a battle about benefits or protections or legal this or that. This is a struggle about what kind of country we want to have. And the question for each one of us, non-gay and gay, is where are we in that struggle? Both Representative Wolf and Mary Bonanno have reminded us that this is not an academic discussion. This is not about designing some legal system for a planet super. This is about what kind of state, what kind of community, what kind of country do we want to have? And each and every one of us is summoned to the opportunity to engage in that struggle. Now, as an activist, I could tell you that there are three elements, in my view, of what good social change activism and advocacy must consist of. And this has been true in every civil rights movement, every one of the ones I described, and the others that continue. The three elements are, number one, to seize and shape the terms of the debate, to find the vocabulary that resonates with people, and to get in there and talk with them, to claim the words that belong to you. And those words are the equal words, the equal choices, the equal opportunities that I think most of us believe everyone ought to have. The second element that must go together with that is that we must engage those who are not yet reached. We must engage the middle. It is sometimes very tempting, and certainly easier, to only talk to ourselves. We can have incredibly great discussions in which we split every, not only infinitive, but every issue, every question, every word, every choice, every tactic, and argue amongst ourselves with the people who are closest to us on the spectrum, and never do the serious real work of engaging that middle. Well, the wonderful news and the sea change that has occurred, as Representative Wolf described, because of the groundwork that was laid when it didn't seem so clear, the sea change that has occurred now in this country is that non-gay people are listening. Non-gay people are talking about gay people and marriage. It was only 8 years ago that the Hawaii Supreme Court first put this question of the denial of full equality before the American people. 8 years ago, people did not put the words gay and marriage in the same sentence. And now, all across the country, every day, with every discussion, people do. Non-gay people have come to understand that the discussion over marriage is central to the discussion of equality for lesbians and gay men. Not just because marriage is as important as Mary described, although it is, but because marriage means something more. And again, that's not just symbolism. Marriage means full and equal participation, full and equal respect for family, full and equal respect for choice. Does that mean that marriage is the only thing that matters? Of course not. We know that. Non-gay people know that. No one is here fighting for mandatory marriage. We are fighting for the freedom to marry. But if we don't engage the middle, if we don't find the vocabulary that they understand, which is also a vocabulary of full and complete equality and entitlement, resonance, then we are not only selling ourselves short, but we are selling them short as well. The middle, the fair-minded people, the non-gay people who are making this decision now, deserve the opportunity to be fair. But if we don't go in there and talk with them and tell them these very real stories and engage them to respond to the better angels of their nature, to see what every court that has looked at this has seen, that when you look at it dispassionately, without prejudice, there is simply no good reason for denying gay people the commitment and responsibilities and protections and equality that come with civil marriage. That is our opportunity now. Do I have time to do one more?
You have 1 minute.
1 minute, good. I'll end with this. This is not, as I said, an academic discussion. And as Representative Wolf pointed out, by engaging when it seems difficult, we can actually get the country to the point where it becomes attainable. And we are at that point. This is attainable. And I'll give you one proof, and if we have time in Q&A, I'll give you plenty of others. But to get this one proof, cast your mind back to the recent debate in the presidential election. In the vice presidential debate, Dick Cheney and Joe Lieberman were asked the question, a man loves a man, a woman loves a woman. Should they have equal constitutional rights? Now, first of all, the fact that that question was asked at all at the presidential level, Representative Wolf can tell you, is quite astonishing and great, and a herald of what he had accomplished. But it didn't stop there, because both of them, Dick Cheney and Joe Lieberman, answered that question by talking about marriage. Why? Because marriage is the vocabulary in which non-gay people hear the words equal, love, responsibility, commitment. Again, it doesn't mean that that's the only relationship that manifests these things, and it doesn't mean that every marriage does, but marriage is the vocabulary. And then both Cheney and Lieberman, a centrist Democrat and a conservative Republican, went on to say that they are open to the idea of gay people marrying. They are wrestling with it. They are talking about it with their friends. Cheney didn't say who he was talking about with. They both indicated, they both role modeled for all of us the power of not writing people off, the power of engaging them. And this only one presidential election after all the candidates were falling all over themselves to sign into law the disgraceful and despicable federal anti-marriage law. We can do this, we can make the change, it is happening. But we can only do it if we don't just talk amongst the people whom we agree with, if we don't just have an academic discussion, but get out there and seize the opportunity to be part of America's civil rights history. And that opportunity is here in Massachusetts, and the time is now. Okay? Thank you.
Access of same-sex couples to marriage. know, I teach family law, and it is a really hard thing to answer the question, what is marriage? But I'm going to offer a answer to that question. It's a relationship between two adults in the state. It's not a two-way relationship, it's a three-way relationship. There's no way into or out of it without the state. You've got to talk to the state to get in, and whether you get out of it through divorce or death, you're doing it under judicial jurisdiction. There's very light rule pressure on people during marriage in the United States, but the exit rules are it's mostly about exit rules. People tend not to notice, therefore, that the state is a party to their marriage until it's ended. They surely don't notice that the state retains power to change the terms of marriages while they are underway. The shift to no-fault in divorce was a massive redistribution of the powers of husbands and wives, we think probably from wives to husbands, and it was accomplished without grandfathering in existing marriages. What else can we say about marriage? It's a very definitive form in the United States. Here are some elements that I identify with it that I think are that are non-negotiable by the partners. It used to be that it was domestic, that is, residential. But that seems to have fallen into disrepute since we couldn't, with equality, we couldn't keep the rule that the husband or one partner dictated where the other partner lived. Although I noticed that the Massachusetts domestic partnership legislation reintroduces cohabitation as a stipulation. It is sexual. It can be annulled for if one enters into it without the intention to participate in sexual relations, and it's mandatorily sexually exclusive adultery laws. The Monica Lewinsky scandal. It's monogamous. No bigamy, no polygamy. It's long-term. No marriage for tonight, no marriage for 2 years. It's economically interdependent. Duty of support, necessaries doctrine. When you enter into a marriage, you're promising to maintain the other person and to execute a duty of support. It brings rules about parenthood that ensure that the non-biological parent is the legal parent of any child born to the spouse. This is called a presumption of legitimacy, and it cuts off the adulterous lover's parental rights. It is a private welfare system. The benefits of marriage, which Mary described, are subsidies which the public provides to the partners of the marriage in exchange for an expectation that the spouses will support each other so that we will not have to do it for you. So for instance, the exemption for marital property that Mary spoke of is a subsidy to the marriage. We assume the duty of supporting the person if the property is exhausted. In return for that, we expect those two people to take care of each other, and their resources are available for the final health expenses, which can be devastatingly heavy. To the extent that it is the only form of relationship which the state subsidizes and applauds, it shepherds, you could even say herds, people into the form of intimacy it demands and away from other kinds of intimacy. That is, it is not a form of freedom from the state. Speaking of freedom to marriage may be a confusing locution. It is a form of regulation. It's like a license. The state creates a monopoly with respect to certain kinds of activity and then grants licenses to some people and not to others. Now, there are many reasons for extending marriage to same-sex couples. I like the equality reason. I go a formal equality reason. and it's in Mary's litigation. It's been in all the litigation. Jane can't do what Joe can do, and that is marry Mary. it's sex discrimination. Simpliciter. No, not very interesting, but logically coherent. The justification says that we want same-sex marriage because we want recognition of loving, committed, and interdependent relationships seems to me to be the justification of the weak. People who need their recognition to have the applause of the state don't have a very loud applause of the team. Commitment is a reason to recognize same-sex marriage. Well, I think that existentialist enough to think that the idea of commitment is empty. If I say I am making a commitment to you by getting married to you, that's maybe true for this moment, but if I change my mind, what bearing does the commitment made yesterday have on me after I've changed my mind? In our system, actually, no, we can change our mind and we do. It may be a commitment for each second, but the idea of commitment over time seems to me, I'm existentialist enough to think it's an empty idea. Now, in our environment, we have unilateral divorce on demand. One spouse can divorce the other just by asking for it. That's what no fault has come to mean. So if we are saying that we want same-sex marriage or we want marriage because it recognizes a commitment, it seems to me that we must be talking about the cultural sanctions that we apply in social life against people who actually want to get out of monogamous relationships, or we want to be able to invoke the exit rules of divorce against the person that we're about to marry. In other words, commitment sounds nice, but peel off the skin and it's about exercising power over the intimate other. Another reason to grant same-sex marriage or to like marriage generally is to protect the kids. It is now aside from adoption, the premier way to legitimate relationships between adults and children who aren't biologically connected. We could ask for adoption instead. Basically, I see marriage as a redistributive project. And it may be really wonderful to have same-sex marriage as an addition to our redistributive mechanisms. But I would ask, why do we want to run a redistributive program exclusively in terms of relationships that are long-term, domestic, sexual, exclusively sexual? What's else on my list? Okay. Now, I want to put out there another justification for same-sex marriage. Once Mary and Evan win, and I bet they will, then descent from marriage gets to be a lot easier. If you're in a long-term relationship, same-sex or cross-sex, and you're not married, you're dissenting from marriage. Now that is impossible for people in same-sex relationships. Their our not being married it sends a muddled signal. Get same-sex marriage, same-sex couples can dissent from marriage in a legible way. Now, marriage is a balloon that's leaking air at a notorious rate. The serial divorce and marriage, the divorce rate, postponed marriage, people are voting with their feet. I envision and think of tonight as the moment that Evan was referring to as the beginning of a long, long process, the end of which cannot be seen and which will involve a difficult struggle. I envision coalitions of people who seek the social vitality and, where appropriate, legal support for a whole range of intimacies that are now out of the range of marriage, domestic partnership, DOMA. Those are the limits that I noticed at the beginning. For instance, and these matters were debated when the legislation, the PAX legislation, was considered in France. So let me, I'm really running over some possibilities about intimacies that were that people sought to have recognized and regularized in France. Non-sexual intimate relationships, sisters, priest, and housekeeper. Non-domestic intimacies, living in another house, so you can play whatever music you want. Non-monogamous intimacies, friendships, erotic and otherwise, and chain relationships. Temporary economic dependencies, roommates. Economically independent intimates. Marriage law imposes economic dependence on people who would, I think, contract out of it if they could. Children with more than two parents. I've taught family law from beginning to end, looking for any opening in the law for a child to have more than two parents, and American law is currently blocking it at every door. Where are the politics of these intimacies? I don't see them anywhere.
What I'd like to do is I have the only power that I have, really, the privilege of the moderator asking the first question, and I'd like to open it up. There are two microphones here, and I guess the tradition, as we say at Williamstown, the tradition in this mountain land, but I guess it's the tradition in the Seacoast, is that you stand there, and this is not Jeopardy. So please do not answer in answer in the form of a question. In other words, ask a question, do not give an answer. And so, but the first question, I think, goes back to a lot of what we've been talking about. One of the things that we studied in class was the ambivalence of public opinion. And public opinion, if the questions are asked in the right way, is actually very favorable to the granting of a variety of civil rights, including domestic partnership, to lesbians and gay men. Phrased in other ways, of course, public opinion is quite hostile. And one of the things that we noticed was that public opinion, while very favorable to the idea of domestic partnership, is not favorable right now, at least in the polls I've seen, and maybe you know, the panelists have seen some more recent ones, have not been favorable to the idea of extending marriage to include same-sex couples. And I guess that raises the interesting kind of question, because it is this question of the sort of long, drawn-out struggle and also the sort of pragmatics of the situation. Because in many ways, the kind of life stories that we've heard and so forth could be responded to in many ways by the examples, I would presume, of Vermont, in terms of saying the privileges of marriage can be given without the name of marriage. And I'm wondering, because I think there is that kind of question that pragmatically that might be easier to do, would accomplish a lot of things in people's real lives. But I hear a lot of dissent from that kind of, the kind of statement I've just made.
So your question is essentially, why not advocate for civil unions as opposed to marriage?
Because it'd be more, public opinion, sort of, yeah.
Okay, I'd like to, just tackle that really quickly from two angles. One, I think, public opinion at any particular time is you're just getting a snapshot. And our opponents actually just recently did a poll, and I think they were shocked to find that with very little information out there, just barely 3 weeks after we filed this case, 39% of the people in Massachusetts are already with us, which I think surprised them. And today my boss was actually doing a radio show, those drive-in radio shows in the morning on WRKO, and he was being beat up on by the host. Everybody opposes this, it's terrible, it's against tradition. They went to the Park Street station for man on the street interviews. Seven people in a row said, "Yeah, no big deal. Makes sense to me." It's really, I think, it's so incredibly dynamic, and the ground is moving so fast that I'm not sure these polls are really keeping up. And this is on a straight up or down, you support marriage. So, and that's a pretty straightforward way of framing up the question. So on the civil union thing, I guess I would just say this. Civil unions, for those of you who don't already know, it's a legal institution that is parallel to marriage for purposes of state laws only, leaves out all the federal stuff. There are huge questions about whether civil unions are going to be transportable from state to state. We certainly think there are good reasons why they should be, but the conventional wisdom is no, we think that's wrong, but in any event, There's real questions about that. So federal benefits are totally off limits. The transportability is questionable. So if you live in Vermont, drive to New Hampshire for work, you know, do you go from being a spouse to a legal nobody? And then, you know, it can get complicated in that respect. And then just the third thing about it, it gets complicated as well because there are some areas where both the federal government and the state government both regulate. And there are real concerns out there about the federal law trumping the Vermont Civil Union law, the state law, the contrary state law at various times. So can Vermont even really treat its citizens equally with respect to state law? But aside from all these details, if you will, you know, I think our position about this is we are looking for equality. We're not looking for a kind of equality, or almost equality, or a little bit of equality, or the kind of equality that's going to make everybody really comfortable. We're looking for full and complete equality. And, you know, I've asked people how they would feel if they traded in, how would they feel about trading in their mayor's certificate for a civil union certificate. I haven't found one taker, because they all feel like they would be giving up something. So, dwell on that for a little bit.
Yes. Well, I certainly agree with all of that, and I would add a couple points, too, which is that, first of all, the two states in the country where we are furthest ahead in the protections and responsibilities and opportunities afforded to gay people to protect their relationships are Vermont and Hawaii. Those are the two states in which we have had the most discussion, the furthest advance, and the beginning of the battle over winning, pulling for equality called the freedom to marry. You don't get half a loaf by asking for half a loaf. The idea that it is easier if we only called it something else, that everybody would just be okay with it, is just simply been proven wrong every single time. We have been doing that approach for decades. I mean, as the two lawyers representing various legal groups, we know what we have litigated. We spent decades in this country litigating. We're not looking for equality. We're not looking for marriage. We're not looking for destabilizing this or that. What we're talking about is this. And you know what? When we ask for the freedom to marry, our opponents are against it. When we ask for protections against being beaten up in the streets, our opponents are against it. They are against big, they are against small. If we were asking for oxygen, they would be against it. So frankly, I believe the way to get full equality is to seek full equality. The way to get other things along the way is also to seek full equality. Janet makes a very important point that I don't think is lost on any one of us, which is that marriage is not the only family form, it's not the only thing we care about. That is absolutely right, and we all understand it right from the very beginning. But what is clear to me, at least, is that by fighting for and engaging people in the discussion around marriage, we have changed people's understanding of the diversity of gay lives, and also invited them to question whether marriage should be the sole criterion. It was only after we began the freedom to marry debate that the majority of American people began to support what I think of as the all-but-marriage effort to throw stuff off the sled to keep us from approaching. And so now you can cite majorities who favor this or favor that, and all of those things are great, and it's very important, and it's part of an important discussion about why marriage should not be the only criterion. But marriage is an important criterion, and we transform those terms of the debate by seeking full equality.
One comment on this. I'm really in agreement with what's been said. I have one little piece, though, that I think is worth putting into this discussion in the context of your question of can you get more people to move over and do this if you do civil unions, and that we haven't said this word yet on this panel, but that has to do with some people in some religions, that the overlap between the word marriage or the concept of marriage and religion, for some people, really skews their view of this issue. And so there is a little piece of me that feels that those people, it is easier to pitch the civil unions totally on the arguments around equality and fairness under the law, and to say basically, you know, this doesn't have anything to do polling or popularity, that may not be a good argument, but I do think that that is an issue that needs to be addressed in this discussion.
First question, please.
Yeah, Sean?
Yes. Could you identify yourself?
Yeah, my name is Ann Morris, I'm here at Kennedy School. First of all, I just wanted to thank you all for coming. Surely, Ms. Bonato and Wilson, I've read a lot by and about your, I think, Use Heroes. And that being said, I'm going to go ahead and critique you a little. I noticed that the defense, that the Freedom to Marry Project and GLAAD's efforts are legal efforts. And so I guess the first part of the question is, why are there not more legislative efforts, efforts to elect a gay marriage friendly state and local representatives, and not more about referendum efforts? And as the second half of that, in response to the Hawaii case and to the Baker v. Vermont case, there are now 35 different states which have Defense of Marriage Acts, and of course the federal government. So there's this huge sort of backlash that's coming not from the legal end necessarily, but from more referendums and legislative efforts. So my question is, you know, why is that type of work not being done on the pro-marriage end, and also how do you handle such a huge backlash?
Actually, far from that being a critique, I 100% agree with you, and I guess there are a couple things I can say. Since we're at Harvard, let me say that I've written a 50-page law review on exactly that subject and invite you to peruse it at your leisure. 21 NYU Review of Law and Social Change. I'll put it online. Not that I would dare to compete with any of the other distinguished academics. But I totally agree with you, and in all seriousness, what we need to do at this juncture of our civil rights movement is to stop thinking this is something that's going to happen overnight, to stop thinking of it something that it's going to be won in one burst of discussion, or one law case, or what I think of as a wartime campaign. When we're under attack on the enemy's terms with their infrastructure, and of course, most of the public is not our enemy. They are the people to be reached. But we have organized enemies, and they are mounting a campaign against us if we are under assault. What we need to do, and by we I mean gay and non-gay people who care about equality, is mount a peacetime campaign, a sustained effort that combines engaging the public, outreach, asking for support, building clergy coalitions, reaching out to people and telling them the kinds of real stories that Mary has told, going to the non-gay people we can reach and talking with them and asking them for their support. You know, as gay movement people, we tend to be pretty good at demanding. And we do the litigation, and that's a very important thing to do, and it's the right thing to do. But demanding is not the same as asking. And what we need to do is also be asking for support in a sustained, affirmative way, with the idea that this is a long-haul effort, like every civil rights movement is, but that if we do the serious work of engaging the middle and going to them and asking them for their support, and not rolling the dice by filing just a lawsuit here or trying to run a six-month referendum campaign there, but instead see this as about engaging the middle in that important dialogue, then we will secure the equality with litigation and legislative efforts that also ought to be happening with allies like Representative Wolf and so on taking it up. But if we don't get in there and engage the middle as part of that climate of receptivity, then we're just taking our chances with any particular bag. That's not the best we can do. The best we can do is committing ourselves now to bringing this home. And the last thing I'll say on that point, going back to your question earlier, Tim, is that it was only 8 years ago that the Hawaii Supreme Court first put this before the country. People hadn't thought about it. Within just 6 years, a historical eye blink, we went from no one talking about this to two-thirds of the American people believing that gay people will win the freedom to marry, according to the NBC News Wall Street Journal poll of September 1999. That shows the power of going out there and engaging. If we don't aim low, but instead get out and do it in the multi-methodology way you are exactly right in describing, then we can do this.
Please.
Hi. I'd also like to thank you all.
Could you identify yourself?
My name is Molly, Molly Durr, and I'm a citizen of the United States. And I'm starting to feel like one. Maybe. My question is about citizenship. It's about marriage and immigration law. Since you touched on all the other major issues that have blown up in front of my life so far, except for this one, I'd just like to ask if you could give some information about what is the current status, either in legal cases pending or in preparation or recent cases, I don't know, I haven't looked into it myself yet, regarding domestic partnership between an American citizen and a non-American citizen. I will sit down and listen. Anything you have to say about that, and make preparations to update my passport in case the INS comes to the door, because I would be deported along with my partner, if that's what you do when you're married. Thank you.
Someone, I'm not sure who wants to address that.
Just to answer very briefly, it's I don't have any good news for you. Apologize for that. The federal government would have passed the Defense of Marriage Act, defined marriage as a union of one man and one woman. When it comes to immigration, which is something that's dealt with only at the federal level, the federal government's powers are at their zenith. The most comprehensive, especially when it comes to protecting our borders from those aliens. So as a result, when you ask about progress, about domestic partners, federal level, citizens and non-citizens, we're really not anywhere. The only thing that's positive to point to in any regard at all, I shouldn't say any regard at all because there's other developments in asylum law, but leaving that aside, the only thing I think to point out is that Representative Nadler in the U.S. Congress has introduced a bill to make it easier for partners to come back and forth and so on. But as you all know, with the present U.S. Congress, that's certainly a long-haul struggle.
The quick thing I would add to that, though, is if you can, instead of just sitting down or feeling the need to update your passport, that's exactly the kind of story that our neighbors and friends in the middle need to hear, that committed couples are denied that are, is otherwise respected as one of the many consequences of gay people being denied the freedom to marry.
Please.
Hi, my name is Adam Sofran. I'm a senior at the college. I wanted to talk about tactics for a little bit, so I have a two-part question. First, for Mary Bonato, can you give us some kind of assessment of our odds of succeeding in this current marriage case here in Massachusetts? And then my second question to Evan Wilson, we've tried Hawaii, we've tried Alaska and Vermont. Where else, what states are next, basically?
An unanswerable question. But then what states, I can actually answer what states are next, all of them, in time. But anyway, with respect to the marriage in Massachusetts, I'm really not into the predictions. All I'm gonna say is I believe that we are in a place where both the courts and the people of Massachusetts will be fair to us. And I think, again, once, as Evan has been saying, and I certainly agree, when we are out there talking to people and shaping the court of public opinion, that's certainly something when there are letters to the editor in the newspaper and there are conversations happening everywhere and it's, you have those sort of surprises like you did on the radio this morning and everybody seems to be in agreement about this. It's the kind of thing that really shapes public opinion and probably makes it even easier for the court. In a sense, it almost creates a safe zone for them that they're not getting too far ahead of the people. And to relate back, I think, to the other question that the woman over here asked, we very much are in both court and the court of public opinion, and I really think that with legislators, Alice Wolf being an incredibly rare and endangered species, you're not often going to see leadership coming out of legislatures. It's very rare. In fact, the fear level seems to go up the closer and closer you get to a statehouse. Usually legislators are following, they are not leading, and I think if we're out there and you're telling your stories and so on, and the people are speaking, then the legislators will eventually follow, and it's not all going to be done through court, actually.
Well, I again agree with everything Mary just said, and I think the most important answer to your question is that there will be litigation in several states over the next several months and certainly years. And litigation is only one part of the work that we all have the opportunity to do right now to make that litigation succeed. The other thing I would say is one way to look at it is we try Hawaii, we try Hawaii. The real way that I look at it, though, is that, number one, Hawaii and Vermont put us tremendously far ahead of where we were. laid the groundwork for the inevitable next battle. And it's up to us now to have the guts and the courage and the wisdom and the foresight and the commitment to fight that next battle and bring it home. And if we do, this is attainable. This is very attainable. The second point I would make in proof of that is that we could have won in Hawaii, and we could have won in Vermont. Contingencies came into play. We didn't rally as much as we could have soon enough to protect what Hawaii had done. And as a result, the right wing, who had a much greater stick-to-itiveness and unity amongst their side, poured millions of dollars in to strangle the baby in its cradle, literally tearing a hole in the Constitution in order to prevent the courts from doing justice. But we had this within our reach, although people thought we would never have it. So now we know we can do it. Now it's a question of doing it. And the answer to what's the next state, well, there's a case in Massachusetts right now. There will be others. And this civil rights discussion is taking place not only in across this country, but across the world. And I'll just close again by saying that this year, for the first time in modern history, lesbians and gay men can now get legally married. The honor of ending that discrimination and allowing that inclusion could have gone to the United States, but now it has gone to Holland, which has become the first country to end discrimination, not just have two separate lines at the clerk's office, but in fact allow gay people to fully, legally, completely marry. If Holland can do it, so can we.
I think we're going to stop after these next two questions because, you know, we can run a little bit over time and perhaps there will be opportunity for discussion afterwards, but we have two people lined up here.
Hi, Cliff Davidson from the college. So there are three things going on in Massachusetts right now. There's the domestic partnership bill. Where was it? Was it introduced in the Senate or the House?
It's actually, there was both the Senate and the House bill.
So there's that, there's the DOMA law, and there's the case. And I'm wondering how you see the interaction between the three of them. Because I wonder if you think there'll be any backlash, like support for the DOMA bill now that we see a marriage being, a marriage case being brought.
Well, I think that was what I was kind of referring to when I mentioned that some people, there was not a marriage, there was no marriage legislation filed and no civil union legislation filed. And there are a sort of multiple opinions on that question. I think if you look at it from the point of view of the discussion that has taken place here, I think that you can look at the court case as a good opportunity for the public to be engaged in a conversation around these issues. I mean, of course, when there are matters in the legislature, that is also true, but because that is so kind of politicized and often relating to individual personalities, the Speaker of the House or the Senate President or whatever, you don't always get quite as much discussion about what is behind this, what about the equality issue. So I think from that perspective, I think that there is a great opportunity in the case in being able to engage the public over a period of time as reports come in about what the progress is. Short term, it probably is the case that it will make, there'll be more ferment around the DOMA legislation. I do not believe that it, personally, I don't believe it will pass. I mean, I'm praying that it will not, and I believe ultimately it will not pass the whole of the legislature. But it will. This certainly will give some impetus, and you know, if right-wing groups are using me to fundraise for their side, you know that they're looking at what is going on. Now there's going to be they're going to have a rally tomorrow, and so we'll probably get a little better idea about what are the groups, you know, what kind of language and rhetoric that there will be. I believe in terms of the legislature, by and large, people actually do not want this legislation to come to the floor. And our best sort of hope, just legislatively, is that the committee, which will be hearing the legislation on, let's say, the 17th, will actually not move it forward. And that's what we will be initially working for, is that will be put into the study. That is the graveyard of legislation.
to the agenda that I laid out tonight. It says, any other relationship shall not be recognized as a marriage or its legal equivalent, or receive the benefits exclusive to marriage in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts as a matter of public policy. So if that's adopted, it would make it very difficult to fragment marriage and multiply the kinds of choices that people have for their relationships. It's specifically about the sublimity and exclusivity of marriage as the only model for intimate relations. And so I wanted to just point to that. It's a reason to not want this legislation to pass entirely independently of the first section on marriage as a relationship between man and woman.
I really want to echo that, because essentially that section 4B would have shut down GLAAD's work in the sexual orientation area, particularly around family law, for the last 22 years. We would have been able to do virtually nothing. And if you want to see an analysis of this bill, there's one that's actually more of a legal analysis and one that's a shorter analysis. Again, feel free to go to the website, GLAAD.org, because we've parsed them thoroughly.
Well, and I would just agree with that, too, and I'm glad that Janet flagged that. The one thing I would change, though, is it's not just an attempt to reify the sublimity of the marriage. What it is an attempt to reify the sublimity of heterosexual marriage. It is an anti-marriage provision, and it shows that what the agenda here is, what this debate over marriage is really about, is not about marriage alone. It is about recognition of gay people. It is about choice. It is about equality. Okay.
Hi, I'm Deidre Britton, Canterburgian, Carb Divinity student, filmmaker, and finally, most proudly, fiance of Ann Marks. And first, I just want to say that Evan Wolfson, you got me quite lightheaded with your discussion of this as an actual movement. I'm actually doing a final project, a very intensive thing, trying to figure out how in the hell we're going to make this a movement. So I've got a few people at this table who agree with me that there is one going on, but it's been very difficult to figure out how to make it coherent. So first, I just wanted to ask that, if possible, at some point, you give us that third point as to how we have one, we have two, and my number three is big and empty. Okay, and then quick question to Mary Bonato. Are there plans to expand the case to more couples in a sort of class action style? Is there the opportunity to expand this, or are these seven couples going to represent what is queer marriage for the entire history of the case?
Sure. Just to recap, the three elements of any good social change movement are, number one, to seize and shape the terms of the debate, number two, to engage the other, not just talk to ourselves, and number three, within doing that climate of receptivity work, to deploy political, litigation, legislative, and other actions to bring it home. But for example, it is a mistake to define the agenda, if you will, of a civil rights movement by the legislative agenda. What is attainable today in the legislature should not be what frames our engagement with the public, or else we'll always be bargaining against ourselves. Rather, it is our job to engage for full equality and to deploy skillful litigation, skillful legislative work as part of the mix.
And I would argue, actually, to add to that, everybody should really read Gene Sharp's three-book series on the development of a nonviolent movement, which outlines exactly what Evan Wolfson's talking about tonight. Gene Sharp.
Just the quick answer to your question. I think the face of this issue in Massachusetts is not just going to be these seven couples in the case, although they'll certainly be part of it. And they're really, I think, an example to say, hey, other people, you can do this too. You can talk about your life. You can talk to your neighbors and your colleagues about why this matters. You can write letters to the editor. You can be public too. Because when I talk to couples about participating in the case, great many people are kind of fearful about it. And then these seven couples happen not to be particularly fearful about it. That's the only reason that they're involved in this. They wanted to be involved in it, and there's a lot of other factors as well. But essentially, I think they are just really a beacon to the rest of us to say, let's get out there and let's do what we can in our own lives, in our own circles, and extend those circles to be much more of a public.